for tuning in to our second episode of Elyrian Cuisine. Today we are going to be making Canis Rabbit Delight. I'm joined here today by my assistant, my high shield Art. He's going to be helping me with this dish today. So, in case you notice on our first video about our cool t-shirts, if Art wants to go ahead and explain it a little bit, I'm going to get started with our rabbit.
Alright, so it was last year, PAX West, we met the developers. They weren't actually there, like they didn't have a booth, but they still showed up. They tweeted out that they were going to be there. The first people to see them were going to get the shirts. So we were, Annie here was hot on Twitter, and we looked for them. We had just happened to find them. We were able to get interviews, shirts, and pictures with them. So yep. It was really cool.
It was cool. Okay, so to start with the rabbit, you're first going to want to find, you want to locate any silver skin and any sinews or fat that might be on the outside of the rabbit before we actually get started. So we're just going to want to go ahead and just take off any of the extra skin, stuff like this. Want to just go ahead and take off. Very important to make sure you get all of the fat off of the rabbit. Unlike a chicken, the fat can taste very, very unpleasant. So once again, I want to go ahead and both sides, take off any sinews, any chunks of fat. Once again, this is going to be very rough because when we're cutting the rabbit, we're going to get a little bit more detailed. Okay, so to start, we want to work with the front legs. They're not connected to the rabbit by bones. These are the easiest to cut off. We want to go ahead and find where the shoulder blade starts and then make the cut. There's the first one. Once again, if you notice, it has a lot of unpleasant stuff on it that we're going to want to cut out. If you have a cat or a dog that you want a special treat for, you can go and keep those and cook them at a later date. If you don't, throw them away. There are certain dishes that you want to go ahead and leave that on for. We're not going to be making any dish that would require that. So once again, taking any of the silver skin off, any of the fat that may have remained, very important. And there's a sinew that we just cut off right there. Perfect. Okay, going to go ahead and work on the second one. Once again, find out where that is. And just cut right off. Very important you use a sharp knife. Dull knives make things difficult. Dull makes things difficult. Look, there's a rhyme for you. Once again, cutting off all the sinews. And I am going to go ahead and rush through this a little bit. I think you guys kind of got the gist of it. Next, the hind legs. Now the hind legs are actually connected at a joint. So what we want to do is kind of feel for that joint. Follow the back of the leg, cut up until you feel the joint and it's visible. Okay, you're gonna see it right there. Okay, and so what we want to do, hold very firmly till you hear that snap. That means we've just dislocated Mr. Cottontail's leg. And it peels right off. Okay, maybe the second one. I know where the bone is. You're gonna hear it pop. There we go. This one came off a lot cleaner. Now, mind you, this is the first time I've ever cut my, done anything with a rabbit, let alone a Canis rabbit. So if you guys have better ways of doing this, please feel free to comment. I'm sure everyone would love to know. Now, I know you guys are asking yourself, this looks really small for a Canis rabbit. Well, you always want to get the Canis rabbits when they're little babies, because as they grow and become more predatory, they tend to get much tougher, and the skin is and the meat is much more difficult to work with. Now, if you don't have access to Canis rabbit, regular rabbit will do. I'm sure any of your butcher shops will have it. Next, we want to work with the bellies, each side. We pretty much want to start right where the belly ends with the main loin of the rabbit. Okay, so we're going to go ahead and cut right down there. Follow up until we get to the rib. And then we're going to want to fillet it off the rib. Try and get as much meat off the rib as possible. Cut as close to the rib as possible. There we go. Like I said, first time working with rabbits. First time filleting anything. So don't be too harsh on it. I did a what could be considered a piss poor job. But it's still going to taste good. Once again, we're going to want to go ahead and of course, you know, make room in your cutting board. Cut off the sinews. Feel the breast for any, or sorry, this is the belly, not the breast. Any rough spots. There's one right there that we're going to want to cut out. Once again, very important to have a sharp knife. See how easy this is? If this wasn't a sharp knife, it would be a lot more difficult. Now, I'm pretty sure I'm wasting a lot of rabbit. But, like I said, first time, not really sure what I'm doing. We're going to go ahead and try and fillet off the rib. Not doing a very good job, because I don't know how to fillet things. Don't know how to fillet.
Now, Anavar, did you send out the Peregrine Society to get this rabbit, or did you do it yourself?
Oh, very, very, very good question. Now, for those of you who aren't familiar with Elyria, the Canis rabbit is actually a very ferocious, carnivorous creature. So, now, its small stature means that a couple of well-equipped adventurers can go out and catch one. They tend to hunt in packs, though. So either you want to separate them, so that way you can find the little children. Once again, larger Canis rabbits, that's all you can find. Do make very good stews. That way you can boil the rabbit. For this particular rabbit, it was actually caught in Whisperwind, Dutchie.
Oh, the bread bowl.
The bread bowl of Blackheart. Okay, so, have some extra meat. I'm gonna go ahead and keep that. So all we have left is the rib cage, the pelvic bone, and like I said, this beautiful cut of meat. So we don't want the pelvic bone, we want to kind of feel where that ends. Usually it's right about, so I want to say, so what's that? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 vertebrae. I'll just go ahead and give it a nice smack with our cleaver. Finish off the cut and toss it. We don't have the trap. There it is. Oh, perfect. Okay. So next, we're going to want to just cut the rib cage off with some kitchen shears.
Will regular scissors work?
No, you should not be using regular scissors. If you're going to be cooking, and if you're going to be cooking something as exotic as a rabbit, invest in some kitchen shears. Okay? It's worth it. Okay. So, now, to prepare this lovely cut of meat, we're going to want to cut about every fourth vertebrae, third or fourth vertebrae, to make really nice bite-sized pieces. So we want to cut around, make a good point, and just break. Beautiful. Again, 1, 2, 3. Now, for this recipe, we're going to want about 2 pounds of rabbit pieces. For us, that was about 2 rabbits. Okay. You can also corner off this piece. I'm not very very good big fan of neck. I'm going to go ahead and toss that. So we're going to add this to our already cut rabbit. Beautiful. Once again, this is about 2 pounds. Okay. Next, we're going to want to go ahead and get about 2 tablespoons of flour. Mix in some salt and pepper to taste. And we're just going to want to go ahead and toss the rabbit in the flour. We're just getting a nice breading, so I mean, you know, a nice film. We're not going to be deep frying this rabbit. This is just going to help in the browning process. Okay, can you please get me a plate? Thank you. We're going to go ahead and heat to medium temperature. 3 tablespoons of olive oil. We're going to be using 1 tablespoon each. We're going to be doing 3 batches of the rabbit. I don't know where my tablespoon is, so we're going to do this math ways. 3 teaspoons, which equal 1 tablespoon. Okay? 1 tablespoon per batch. Main reason we're cooking the rabbit in 3 batches is because if you overcrowd the pan, the rabbit's not going to brown correctly. It's just not going to work very well. So we're going to go ahead and use 3 batches. And you know what? Oh, I think it needs a little more olive oil. So, always go with your gut when cooking. Very important. The only thing you can do is mess stuff up royally. Okay, so we're going to wait for that olive oil to heat up. So it looks like the olive oil has heated up quite a bit, right to about medium heat, which is what we want. Once again, 3 batches, so we don't overcrowd the pan. If you use a stainless steel pan like I do, you want to go ahead and make sure that the meat is at around room temperature so it doesn't stick. Okay? So we're just going to go ahead and place. And you know, about 5-6 minutes on each side until nice and brown. So the rabbit is nice and brown now. As you can tell, it has a nice brown crispy outer crust. We went ahead and put the garlic in with the remaining oil just to get a nice light brown, and then added the parsley. Now you don't want to cut the parsley until you're ready to add it into the pan. Parsley has a tendency to lose flavor fairly quickly, usually 5 to 10 minutes after it's cut, so it has to go in fresh. Okay, and we just want to cook the parsley for a couple minutes until it's soft. So, a few minutes literally, until it's nice and soft and starting to break down. Okay, now we want to go ahead and start adding the rabbit back into the pan. Okay, perfect. So, after we add the water, the rabbit into the pan, we next want to add our white wine. I'm using a Sauvignon Blanc. You want to use any white wine that's very good for cooking. We're going to start by adding about 300 milliliters. In. Now, if it doesn't look like it's covering the rabbit, we're just going to go add a little bit more. Perfect. It's about good. So, now that we've added the wine in, we're going to heat it up a little bit until the wine starts boiling and bubbling. Once the wine is bubbling, we want to cook it until it's about
reduced by half. Once it's reduced by half, we're going to want to top off until all the rabbit is fully covered and submerged. Okay, so let's go ahead and reorganize a little bit. Try and get the rabbit in here so as much of it is submerged as possible. So feel free to jam it in there. Don't worry, you're not going to feel anything. Okay, so like I said, we're just going to go ahead and roll this to a boil and let the wine reduce to about half. We had just allowed the wine to reduce to about half and add enough water to make sure that all of the rabbit was fully submerged. We are now going to lower the heat to a simmer. And we're actually going to let this simmer for about 40 minutes covered until the rabbit's nice and tender. You're going to know the rabbit is tender when it starts pulling apart from the bone and it just starts separating. If you need to do it for more than 40 minutes, just add a little more water to make sure everything's submerged, okay? So, we're going to go ahead and let this cook for 40 minutes. While we wait for that, we're going to go ahead and start with our mashed potatoes. So, you should go ahead and have a nice big pot of water boiling. You're going to want to go ahead and, you know, peel the potatoes, cut them into cube-like sections, make sure you rinse them several times to reduce the amount of starch. Add them into boiling water. And we're pretty much just going to wait for this water to come back to a boil. And we are going to boil the potatoes until they easily come apart when you poke them with a fork. So this is about the size you want. The smaller you cook, the smaller you cut them, the quicker they will cook. So once again, we're going to go ahead and wait for that to come to a boil. Welcome back. So we have our rabbit simmering in our pot. Remember, we want to do it for about 40 minutes. But while we wait, we're going to get our mashed potatoes ready. So we've had them boiling after we cut them. We strained them water already. And you just, like I said, you want them to boil until they break down. So if you can look right here, it breaks down very easy. This is exactly what we want. So what we started first is you're going to take about 2 tablespoons of butter and melt it, get it to about a simmering temperature, and then add two cloves of garlic. Sorry, when you cook with wine, you tend to drink a little bit of it. 2 cloves of garlic until they're nice and light golden brown. What that's going to do is it's going to help the flavor of the garlic fully infuse into the butter. That's kind of my little secret there. Once that's fully infused, you're going to add about half a cup of half&half. You want to use half&half as opposed to milk. It's going to make the mashed potatoes a lot creamier and a much more pleasant consistency. I'm saying about half a cup because I don't measure when I make this. This is my own little recipe, I just don't measure. So we're going to go ahead and take this little mixture that we made, once again about 2 tablespoons of butter, 2 cloves of garlic, and about half a cup of half&half. And we're going to add it to the 6 diced and cut potatoes. With your stand mixer, you're going to want the whisk blade attached. Lock it in, set it to a low speed. And we're just going to let that run until it's fully incorporated, until it looks like mashed potatoes. Now to this, we're going to add about 2 tablespoons of sour cream. I don't know why I have the sour cream. My mom added it when she made it. It makes them taste really good, so I add it too. And that's really why we do most of the things we do, right? You see the family members do it. We do it because it tastes good. It keeps tasting good. We have no idea if it actually adds to the flavor, but it doesn't hurt. So now, it's a very good consistency of mashed potatoes. If you look, beautiful. Next, going to add a very fun mixture of our secret seasonings. So really what this is about one packet of Sazon Goya. You can find this at the Hispanic aisle of any supermarket you're in. Also about 2 tablespoons of Adobo. You can also find that in the Hispanic aisle. I think it just adds an extra quality bit of flavor to the mashed potatoes that you're not really used to tasting.
It also changes the color.
It also changes the color. Sazon has a herb in it called achote, and what that does is it has adds a really nice red to any dish you're making. My mom used to use it all the time in pork chops. I was never really sure what it was, and I would always ask her to make me the red pork chops. I just assumed that's what they were. So we're gonna mix that up until it's fully incorporated. We're about done there. Take the whisk paddle off. Okay. Thank you. Art is gonna go ahead and scrape down the pan. And we're gonna just get out of the casserole pan real quick. Once again, this is also something my mom did. Don't know why she did it, but I do it because it tastes good. I'll take that. We're just gonna wanna make a nice even layer across our casserole pan. And then to top that off, we're gonna just do a layer of cheddar cheese. This just, it adds an extra flavor profile to it. The texture is really good. And who doesn't like cheesy mashed potatoes? Really, come on.
I believe we're also going for taste and not health in this.
Absolutely. This is not a healthy food channel. Disclaimer, not a healthy food channel at all. We are not vegan. We are not vegetarian. We are not raw food. We are not paleo. It's just food that you like to eat. So we're going to go ahead and put this in the oven for about 5-10 minutes, just until the oven gets nice and warm and starts melting that cheese. Set to about 350, that should be fine. Like I said, we're just going to be melting the cheese. And now we wait. Welcome back again. We are finally ready for the big reveal. We have our mashed potatoes. The cheese is nice and melted. We have our Canis Rabbit Delight. Nice and tender, the meat falling off the bone. Now, right when the meat falls off, right when you know it's done, at about the 40 minute mark, you're going to want to add the olives, the 20 whole olives that we talked about earlier, and let them simmer there for about 10 minutes after. Okay, so let's go ahead and get started. We're gonna start with a bed of the cheesy mashed potatoes. Very good. Okay, and to that, we're gonna find a really nice, beautiful piece. There we go. Top it off with a little bit of the juice.
And don't forget your bread.
And of course the bread, just your general French bread, just add that little bit of kick. And there it is, our Canis Rabbit Delight on a bed of mashed potatoes. I would tip it over a little bit more, but the juices are running down. We had planned to tip over, but it's running down. Okay, let's go ahead and give it a try. There we go.
Oh, yeah, that's a good piece.
That's a good piece. Okay. Scoop up some mashed potatoes. Okay.
That is really good. The, go ahead and try some.
Oh, you want me to try some?
The rabbit is extremely tender. It's very lean meat, so I was very worried about overcooking it. But the 40 minutes really helped. The cheesiness of the mashed potatoes really offset the very subtleness of the rabbit. It's amazing. Once again, guys, thank you so much for watching this video. If you made it all the way through, I hope you did. I hope you liked it. You know, we're doing this because it's fun. We did something like this, once again, inspired by Chronicles of Elyria. The Canis Rabbit, one of many unique creatures that are going to be populating Elyria. Once again, we have our little comments up here, left side. Left side, I'm being told by the cameraman, it's actually going to be over here. Click on it. Click on the little card thing right up here. It's going to send you to the Chronicles of Elyria YouTube channel where you can learn more. The developers are posting really interesting Q&As that they're, you know, they're interacting directly with their community. There's also a card up there for our Zen of Onslaught YouTube channel. That way you can see what we do. You can see what we do in the games that we play. Once again, please subscribe if you like this. Our next episode is going to be featuring a Svelrosi delicacy. It's going to be baked Svelrosi cod on a bed of wild rice. Really exciting.